You agree with Lindsey Graham and John McCain, the blasts they're delivering at Hillary Clinton today?
Well, Benghazi happened after I left office, after I retired, so I really don't know the particulars. I think that the key question is, as Senator Feinstein said, was the information ever brought to her attention? And if so, what was done? But I think that's an important question as far as her role personally.
I know you weren't in the government anymore at the time of the Benghazi attack, but everything you've read, everything you're hearing, does it make you more or less inclined to believe she would be qualified to be Commander-in-Chief, President of the United States?
Well, let me use a parallel situation. I fired a number of people at the Department of Defense, including the Secretary of the Army over Walter Reed and the Secretary of the Air Force over nuclear matters. And in both cases, it was not because they hadn't known something had happened. It was after it had happened, did they take it seriously enough? And it seems to me that's an important question. It's completely conceivable to me that the Secretary of State would not have known about a request for additional security from an ambassador, that would have gone to various other parts of the department.
But do you think that what she did afterwards disqualify her, as the people you fired disqualified them?
Well, as I was saying, I wasn't in the government at the time, so I actually don't know what happened after the fact, but that would be an important question for
me. So you're open on that. Here's a question that one of our followers on Twitter, Kristen, sent to us when I asked for some suggested questions to you. Will he support Hillary in 2016? Would he serve in her cabinet?
Well, I think that with this book, the chances of my coming back to Washington are probably not very high. And as far as my wife is concerned, probably non-existent. As for Secretary Clinton, I make clear in the book that I have a lot of admiration for her and considered her a valued colleague when I was in government. By the same token, I don't think that the Democrats want a Republican handicapping their 2016
race. But is she someone conceivably you could endorse?
Well, I've never gotten into politics, never taken a political role since I first entered the government in 1966, and frankly, I don't see any reason to start now.
So you're gonna stay out of it. Is that what?
Absolutely.
That's what I'm hearing. All right, you are very tough on a lot of people in this book, a very candid book, I must say. But Congress, and I'm going to read just the sentence from the book, Duty: uncivil, incompetent in fulfilling basic constitutional responsibilities, micromanagerial, parochial, hypocritical, egotistical, thin-skinned, often putting self and re-election before country. This was my view of the majority of the United States Congress. Wow. I mean, you didn't mince any words there at all. Was there anybody you actually liked in Congress?
Absolutely. There are actually quite a few members that, as individuals and as people, I liked and enjoyed, and some that I really respected.
Give me an
example. That was my reaction.
Give me an example who you really admire.
Well, one of the persons that I talk about, actually, to take the chairman and vice chairman of the, ranking member of the Armed Services Committee, I had a lot of respect for Carl Levin. He and I disagreed with almost everything, but when Senator Levin told me he would do something, he did it. He was very political about a lot of issues. He, I think, went after my predecessor, but I could take Senator Levin at his word. Same thing with Senator McCain. Senator McCain was always interesting to deal with in hearings, but by the same token, I think he was very important and helpful in my efforts to cut some wasteful defense programs. And I found that he also would keep his word.
I want to get through a lot of important issues. Let me move on to Iraq right now, which seems to be boiling over, as you well know. Knowing what you know now, and we're all obviously a lot smarter with hindsight, should the United States have invaded Iraq back in 2003?
Well, I say in the book that I was, along with everybody else, a believer that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction. Part of the reason everybody believed it was because Saddam let everybody believe it.
But he didn't have it.
That was an intelligence failure. And it was.
The question is specifically, knowing what we know now, that there were no weapons of mass destruction stockpiles in Iraq, was that invasion in March of 2003 a mistake?
Well, I think that I've said all along, and I continue to believe, that'll have to be a judgment made 10 or 20 or 30 years from now. The fact that the information on which we went to war was wrong will always taint the war, no matter what history's ultimate judgment is.
Because you're very blunt in this book. You admit a lot of successes, a lot of failures, but you're reluctant to say at this point, and we know a lot more, obviously, now than we knew in March of 2003, you're reluctant to acknowledge, to say this war was a mistake.
Well, I think it's too early to draw a final conclusion, but I do say that after the initial success, there were a number of amazing blunders and mistakes that turned an early victory into a long and grinding war. And I think we made a lot of wrong assumptions, whether the length of the war or how soon it would end and so on. I think I'm pretty candid about all of the mistakes that were made. But in terms of the ultimate judgment, even when I was in office, I was reluctant to draw a final conclusion on whether historically this will prove to be a mistake. I will tell you the one condition under which I think it might come out okay, and that is if 20 or 30 years from now, the removal of Saddam Hussein is seen as the first crack in a wall of authoritarianism in the Middle East, that after we get through the period of turbulence and problems that we're having today, ultimately leads to a more democratic and prosperous Middle East.
Because it looks today...
Frankly, like today, I think that's a long shot.
It's a long shot. It's a civil war is erupting. What's happening in Syria could explode inside Iraq right now. And the big winner may be Iran, because its influence from Iran through Iraq, through Syria, through Lebanon has been expanded.
Well, and I acknowledge in the book that one of the consequences of our invasion of Iraq was ultimately to strengthen Iran's role and influence in the region. So what I just posited is the only scenario that I see that ultimately would make people think that the decision to invade Iraq was a good thing.
Because as you know, the United States, we lost thousands of American troops, tens of thousands came home injured, hundreds of billions of dollars spent, and a lot of them are now asking, and they're looking at what's going on in Fallujah, in Ramadi, and elsewhere, where so many American troops were killed and hurt and injured, and they're saying, what happened here?
I think that our troops accomplished their mission when in 2008 and 2009, we handed over to the Iraqis a stable, relatively secure, relatively democratic country. We basically handed them their future on a silver platter, thanks to the sacrifices and the courage of our troops and the civilians, American civilians who served there. What has happened subsequently, first of all, I think, is Prime Minister Maliki's refusal to try and include the Sunnis in a multi-sectarian government, his effort to arrest his Sunni vice president, Hashemi, and other senior Sunni officials, his failure to invest any money in Anbar and the Sunni areas. He basically has given the Sunnis no reason to believe this government serves their purposes or is good
for
them.
There were so many people predicting that would happen, no matter how courageous and brave and brilliant our troops were, given the historic rivalries between the Sunni, the Shia, the Kurds, the tribal rivalries within these various groups that have been going on for hundreds of years. To believe that we were going to achieve this pro-American democracy, a lot of folks were saying, and I was in Fallujah back in 2005, they were saying to me, soldiers, you know, what was going on? Do we really think we're going to resolve this thing and create a stable democracy?
What I'm trying to say is that I think our troops accomplished their mission, which was to stabilize the country and create a circumstance there where we could leave Iraq without it being a strategic disaster for the United States with global consequences. But the second thing that's happened, over which Maliki has had very little control, is the spillover from the civil war in Syria and the resurgence of al-Qaeda there and other extremists, which has spilled over into Iraq. And there, I think whatever effort we can make in Iraq in terms of providing weapons or whatever to the government, to help them fight this back. But the key is Maliki reaching out to the Sunnis. There's a few signs over the last few days that maybe he's gotten a wake-up call and may start to do that.
I'll believe that when I see it.
I wouldn't bet the ranch on it.
I wouldn't bet much on it either.